like the song we like?
Still recording.
Yeah, it is recording. I had it on TV mode, it was recording. So I texted Rishi to ask him. And he said it should be in auto mode. So I just changed it to auto. It still shows it's recording. I don't know. I haven't used this camera. It looks like it is recording.
But that's just a focus. Auto is just a focus mode. That's it. It's got nothing else.
And it's on video and it's recording.
Yeah, yeah. Auto is just the focus. That's
okay. Right. Yeah. Wake up song. Folks all around. Isn't it very sad? Right? Isn't it extremely sad to see all the homeless people?
Yes.
They have run out of money. They don't have money to pay their rent. They don't have money to pay for food. And we can't really say that they didn't manage the money properly because there might be circumstances that led them there. But many of them, maybe a few of them, didn't manage the money well. They gave it away, they partied hard, they did drugs. And look where they landed, right? It is sad, but on the other side, every time you see a homeless person, it's a big lesson. The big lesson is you have to learn to manage money, because God gives us money, not to throw it away, not to be frivolous, but to manage it. And guess what? A startup is just like life. A startup will also die and become homeless if you don't manage the money properly, right? So managing money in a startup is extremely critical. If there's one thing you can take away from today's class, is even the best of ideas, even the greatest of people working on those ideas, even the best of the markets, even the most of your passion coming out, but if you don't manage your money around it, you can't go anywhere. It all has to be managed. So let's start running today then. But before we do that, as I do every week, we will do a recap. Next, please. So we are on week 5. We are past the halfway mark, right? We feel good about it, right? Are we feeling good about the learning so far? If anybody is not feeling good or has missed a class or two, please, please, please come to me. I will take an extra class if needed. I will teach you one-on-one if needed. If you're not feeling good about it, let me know about it, right? I will stay back here if you want, or I can come another day. But if you have missed any of those first 4 weeks, we'll get you back on track. But if you have, then guess what? You're well underway. You're more than halfway there in learning how to be a great entrepreneur. And that makes me super proud. That's I can't tell you how much happiness it gives me with all of you guys. So today we're going to do financials. And the next 2 weeks are also critical topics. Next week, look at the whole marketing angle. After that, we look at intellectual property, and we will call it a wrap with your business plans being ready by that time. So hopefully, and we will cover this later today, your business plans are well underway in terms of having started and getting to a place where we can start working together on it. Next, please. So here's the quick recap of the 4 weeks. If you catch the buzzwords here, I play a tag cloud game here. Tag cloud is about buzzwords. And if you understand these buzzwords, if you understand all of them, then you caught up. Then you know the first 4 weeks. That's my goal and when I do a recap. So does everybody understand these words? Yes? Show of hands? Everybody understands these tag words? Is there a particular tag word that is confusing that I could cover, maybe?
In week 4, the word pivot, I think.
Wait, I will cover that. Is there any word I can cover? Paper money, nice.
Exit.
Exit, nice. Exit. Exit, pivot.
Paper money.
Paper money, exit, pivot. 3. Shout out.
Incorporation,
we cover that, okay.
Integrity.
All right, nice, I like that. That's my favorite topic.
The hacker way.
The hacker way, okay. We'll cover, let's do this then. Let's do it week by week. So first week we came in here with all your parents. Now your parents have gone away. There's mostly you guys, some parents are left. And we talked about passion and the connector. Remember the connector? Right, what's on one side? There's a problem. On the other side is passion. Only when you connect those two with your creativity does magic happen. Right? That was week 1. Very important. Always think about your passion. Day after day, think about how I want to change the world with my passion. You will find a problem, you will connect those two, and you will be super successful entrepreneurs. And at that time when you come to me and said, this is what I did, it'll make me super, super proud. Week 2, we talked about the traits of entrepreneurs. We talked about what is important for you to, if you can learn a few things, as I said, the tricks of the trade, also how you can hone your personality, what you need to become. If you can do these things, these are traits that are shown by the best of best entrepreneurs. Right? We talked about so many great entrepreneurs and the successes they've had. You know, it first of all is very important to be a leader, right? And how to act and behave like a leader. A lot of that is inborn in you because your parents are leaders, right? Your parents have come all the way. Many of us have come halfway around the world. They've taken huge risks in coming to this country. Some of us, like myself, came with less than $50 in our pocket, not a job, nothing, and we made it hugely successful here, right? Learn from your parents. And guess what? The good news here is you have the genes to be a leader because your parents are leaders. Right? Genes are very important too, right? In this world. The fundamental, most important aspect of there is no substitute for
hard work.
There is no substitute for hard work. We learned that in week two. We learned about integrity. Right? We talked about why it's important that people who don't have integrity, where do they land up?
Yeah.
Why are our jails overflowing?
Because we don't have integrity.
Right. The class before this talked about the Bhagavad Gita and talked about how we are taught that when you have to make the right decisions, there'll always be a wrong path and the right path. Right? Usually the wrong path is the easier path, guys. When you are at crossroads, the wrong path and the right path, the wrong path is always the easiest path. And many, many people take that and they end up in our overflowing jails. Always take the right path, path with integrity. We learned about that. And we learned about giving back. Right? We learned about social good. We learned about how it is important as you become successful to lift everybody around you. Because if you lift people around you, then you become what? More successful, right? So we learned, that was week two. Week three, we said, okay, first 2 weeks were common sense weeks. Week three, we said we're going to engage now in deep startup mechanisms of how things are run, how a few startups got started. We learned about what a VC is, right? Very important for an entrepreneur, the best friend. Because guess who you go to when you need money? You go to the VC, right? We talked about the business plan. And we said the business plan is fundamental to everything you do. In life, in a startup, when you work for a corporation, when you're running for school elections, when you are, whatever you do, there is always a plan and there's a business plan. And I gave you a template of the business plan and I talked about the components that you can use in any place in life. Take that document and you will find that whatever you do in life, that template will help you. But then there was a very important aspect of how to make it tuned and honed in for a startup. And we started building the business plan. And we talked about the Hacker Way, which is Mark Zuckerberg's manifesto to the world. And his manifesto said a few things. One is, move fast. Don't dwell on things, right? Don't keep thinking about, I want to do something, I'll do something right. Mark Zuckerberg said, move fast, run. Mark Zuckerberg also said, it's okay to break things, because guess what? When you move fast, you break things. You always break things. And it's okay to break things because what will happen? What will happen when you break things?
You will learn.
Unless you fall, you'll not learn. When you're learning to ride a bicycle, especially without the training wheels, the point that you learn to ride a bicycle is only after you fall. If you don't fall, guess what? You'll never learn to ride a bicycle. And that is a very important lesson in life for all of us. So that was the Hacker Way. And last week, we got even more geeky, right? We got even more, in essence, to a point where we talked about concepts. We talked about how to incorporate your company, right? Incorporation is, you can't just do business willy-nilly, right? You have to have a foundation, you have to have a formal mechanism of doing a business, and that was incorporation. We talked about how most startups get incorporated in Delaware, remember? Right? And how we then issue shares. Right? We talked about how shares constitute ownership. And you guys learned a great thing. I saw many people surprised here, which was most of us here, based on our parents' investments, own. We are owners. We actually own companies like Google, Apple, right? We learned that, correct? Because in the investments that we have shares in this company. And it doesn't matter if you own one share, 100 shares, 1,000 shares, 1,000,000 shares that in Google the founders own, a few million shares, you still are an owner even if you own one share. We are part owners of these big companies. And that was exciting, right? I saw all of you guys amazed last week, or when we met last. We talked about paper money, where the shares are not worth any value until you have an exit event. An exit event is the one that gives you liquidity to the money, which in essence only comes about when someone is either willing to buy you or when you go public as a company. Everybody remember paper money? Is that clear? Right? What is paper money? It is virtual money, it is not real money till you actually make the company successful. Correct? And then we talked about exit, obviously, which creates the mechanism of taking the paper money and making it real money. And we talked about pivot. And this was another important thing that we learned last week, or the last time, that every startup founder will tell you, the idea that I started with of my company is not the idea where the company is now running and humming and really moving forward successfully. Every one of them had to pivot. And it's okay, because Mark Zuckerberg said, move fast, you will break things, you will learn from breaking those things and better your plan and move forward. That's a pivot, so you're pivoting. Right, as you come across, a lot of you called me or emailed me over the break, right? You said, Amit Uncle, we have this idea, do you think it will fly? And my input was, try it, and if it doesn't, we will pivot, right? A lot of you emailed me and said, hey, is this idea something that you think we can bring to the market? And every one of my answer was, unless you try it, you don't know about it, right? So that's what was pivot. And sorry, I'm spending more time than necessary on this, because these are your building blocks. This is the foundation of your learning. And I can stay as long as we need, but I want to make sure that you're comfortable around these terms. Does that make sense? Yeah?
Yes.
Can I see a show of hands as to that these make sense? Wonderful, wonderful. Everyone, I see all of your hands. That's so awesome. Okay, next page. So then, I will segue into financials. And the segue is this concept of what happens to successful startups. Successful startups, we talked about exit. An exit takes two fundamental forms. One form is you either go public, or the second form is you sell your company. There are lots of different ways, but those are the fundamental ways. You can merge, and then we won't go into the complications, but a successful exit is when you've converted your paper money to real money by doing one of those two things. And all of this aspect of exit and success, all of that is driven by making sure you're counting it up. And what do you count up? Financials, right? So you can see how today's class is also very important. You will learn today about financial statements. You will learn today on how you can start making sure that when you build a startup, you're thinking through how I'll make money on one side, on the other side, how I will minimize my costs. Right? Those are important aspects. So that's financials. Next, please. Okay, so we have a little bit of an exercise on how to think financials. Right? So a little bit of a think about, you have an idea of an app. How many people here in their startup are doing an app? A lot of you, right? So when you're doing the app and you're making a business plan, in the business plan template, you have these questions emerging for you, right? How many of you have begun or at least have some kind of getting into the business plan aspects? Okay, not all of you. I would suggest you start. It's time you start. You take the business plan template. Does anybody know how a backup? Does everybody know where to find a business plan template?
Yes.
Does anybody know not? If not, then please come and see me afterwards, because it's very important for you to start building that template, building on top of that template. So what's unique about your app? What else do you think your app users would be willing to pay for it? We talked about this in week 2, right? What business models do competing apps use and how well they have worked? So thinking through these things, underlying in all of this is a lot of money criteria, right? The money criteria that's emerging from here are a few components. I want you guys to think about what the components are that revolve around something to do with money. And I'll come back to think about it. So what concept is emerging from here that talks about money? Anybody? How about how to price your application?
How much would people pay for it?
How would you price your product? When you have product, you have to think about, will you charge $1 for it or $100 for it, right? So that's fundamentally financials, pricing, because it has dollar value attached to it. What else?
You have to also find out how much is your profit according to your, how much money you use, and how much is product.
Exactly.
And how much is sold.
Exactly. So there is this aspect of profit, which is a connected output from something else. One is the price. Let's build on that a little bit. So hold your thought.
What types of materials do you use?
Now we're getting into the other side of, so when you price your product, it is how much you will charge. But the other side of it is how much will it cost you, right? So if you have to build, my famous example, right? Is if I have to build a new shoe, remember my shoe analogies?
Yeah.
I don't know why I started with that, but I did. So don't we have to find out how much the leather will cost for it, right? We have to find out how much the laces will cost for it. We have to find out how much the sole will cost for it. We have to find out how much labor will take to build the shoe out. And if you add all of that up, what is that? That's your total cost, correct? Now say your total cost is $15, and I sell this shoe for $50. Now is that a profitable business or a loss-making business?
Profit.
It cost me $15 to make this, and I sold it for $50.
Profit.
Profit. How much? Wrong. Profit how much? That's a trick question, guys. Profit how much?
$35?
No. Nope. There's a trick question.
It depends on how much you sell.
No.
Percentage.
You guys are. Please don't come up and hit me on the head, because there are two shoes. So it's $15 for this and $15. Can you buy this one shoe? I don't think so. You guys are on the right track. So it's a profitable venture, exactly, right? So in this mix of financials, as you think through the app, you're thinking about how much will people pay for it, how much do you assign a price for it, what are the costs associated for it, and therefore, when you add all of that up, there is this aspect of what we call revenue. Suppose you have the app selling for $1, and you sell 10,000. How much would be your revenue?
$10,000,
because that's how much money you totally made by the money coming in, right? So how and when will you make money, and how much? And the other side of the equation is, It costs you basically some software engineers to come and build the app. It costs you market research. You rented a place and you have to pay for it. All of that are costs. Right? So you see how financials are emerging, the two sides of the finance. And that basically constitutes what we call the financial statements. It's as simple as that. So when someone comes to you and throws out funky terms like profit and loss statement and balance sheet and all of this, you hear it on CNBC. All of you watch Shark Tank, I remember, right? It's nothing but that. It's very simple concepts, right? How much money you made, how much it cost you. At the end of the day, if you have that equation right, you have your financials covered. You can go home for today. It's as simple as that. Make sense? You guys are so sharp. Next piece. Okay. Now, when you sell that app, there are some very interesting concepts that emerge, which I want you guys to learn, which is, it's not about only taking an app and selling it for a dollar. I wish life were that easy. Right? There are multiple different ways by which you can make money. And this slide will give you ideas about it. I saw too many, all of you people, most of you say, put your hands up for making an app. So if you think about it, your app and how you sell it, each one of these models can fit on it. Right? The one model we talked about was selling it for a dollar. Right? Number three, you charge for it, you charge a dollar for it. If you sell 10,000, you make $10,000. Actually, Apple will keep a percentage of it, but you make a lot of money and you're made. But the other way is to make money too, right? So who wants to start talking about some of these and what they are? Okay, pick one. I'll come around. Pick one which is your favorite and talk about how it works. Yeah? That's right. So what people do is they probably sometimes give the app for free, you download it, but you can't do everything with it. And then you have to go in and pay to unlock more features. That's the freemium model.
I like the idea of free, but with ads. Like, you can, like if I'm Clash of Clans, or Facebook, I'm Facebook, and a person from Walmart comes to me, and he asks, I want to put my ad inside your app. On your page.
Correct.
And that page owner will cost him money. And if the people on Facebook who come to that page, they will see the Walmart ad and they'll go to Walmart. So Walmart will make money as a lot.
Advertising is such a beautiful thing, right? You have someone else paying for you, right? So here is an exercise for you guys. Facebook has how many users? A billion uniques every day show up on Facebook, right? They have a total of, I think, 1.3 billion now. Think about if Facebook charged a dollar per year for that application. How much money would Facebook make per year?
A lot.
1.3 billion, right? There are 1.3 billion users. Suppose you have to, when you have to go use Facebook, you have to pay a dollar, right? All of you, right? So you pay a dollar and then you get to use Facebook for a year, so Facebook will make $1.3 billion. But how much does Facebook charge today for the app?
Zero.
How much money do they make per year?
Billion.
10 times a billion. Right? So was it better for them to charge a dollar or go with all of the advertising that you see on Facebook? Right? So the advertising that comes on Facebook is paying Facebook to run their service. They're giving it to you for free, but the Walmarts, the Procter & Gambles, the diaper ads you see are paying Facebook. And they're earning 10 times what they could by selling the app for a dollar. Isn't that beautiful? Mm-hmm. Okay, let's look at the more.
For in-app purchases, so if you're playing a game and like in some games they have lives, if you run out of lives, you can buy more lives or gems or anything you need.
That's right. Inside the app, and it's similar to the freemium model, but in this case, you could have paid for the app. But guess what? They don't stop at that. They'll say, okay, now for you to unlock more features, you have to start paying more. Exactly, it's called subscription, right? Why should you just charge a dollar one time and go? Think about if you're going to add continuous value for the consumer, then you can charge them maybe every year, maybe every 6 months or every month.
Like they can, people get like, I see them like all the time, they're like, they have some demos for like games and stuff, so like if you want, the real app is money, but people can get the demo for free, so.
That's right. That's also fits into two or three of these models. Who else? We haven't covered all of
them. For paid apps, maybe the app costs you more money because of special features, and I just mean to all the other apps to make it
pay. Yeah. You could just make it very simple paid apps.
I don't know which one this is, but like sometimes the users of the app are like annoyed by all the ads, they can
pay
like extra money to say, okay,
no,
there.
Right. Yeah, that's a great one. I don't think that's covered here. Give me five. Which is a hybrid model from this. I like how you're thinking. That's wonderful. Right? You don't have to choose one of these, guys. Be creative. So when someone says, hey, I don't like ads, so you have the option in there to say, okay, if you don't like ads, then you start paying. So Facebook could say, hey, if you don't want to, if you don't like to see all the ads that come up, pay me $10 a month. Right? Fair enough. Some people will do that. I pay Yahoo for premium email, and because emails come with so many ads all around it, so I don't like to see an ad in my emails. So I pay a yearly fee to Yahoo. I do that. Good point. Are there any more? Did we talk about? I think we're missing one. Yeah, sponsorship.
So for sponsorship, it's kind of like when people want things, they like open an ad. They want like, so in a game, if they want like free items, they would open an ad to get those free items. But the person who owns the ad also gets money, and so does the app.
Yeah, absolutely. So someone else could sponsor, right? So how about we call Facebook Pampers Facebook, right? So we call Facebook Pampers Facebook. So everybody who gets the app on their phone sees Pampers Facebook, so you go in and press Pampers Facebook, and you see no ads. So in this case, what Procter & Gamble may be doing is paying Facebook, sponsoring that app, right? And so you see that in a lot of games, as you pointed out, where you see in the game that when people are, say, driving around, they see Coca-Cola banners on the side, or the car may have a Toyota big logo on it. Those are all sponsorships, right? Where you get someone else to not make it as intrusive as an ad, but sponsor kind of the flow of the ad, right? Okay, one more.
Number five, paywalls. They're like sometimes magazines that you have to subscribe to get the latest things
that's
that
right.
Have been coming up.
That's right. So this is another interesting one, which is, there are companies like TrialPay. TrialPay got bought by Visa, where they said that, okay, we will let you use my service for free, but you have to try this other service and pay for it, right? So that's a great point. Okay, we'll move on with the point. Now, do all of you who are building apps know how you're going to charge for your app? Show of hands, right? Has this given you ideas on how you're going to charge for your app? How you're going to make money? I don't see many hands. What's the confusion? How are you going to charge for your app? Are you clear for those people building apps? Yes? We have some distracted folks. Okay, good. Looks like you guys get it, the pricing model. Okay, so now it gets a little tough, right? This is where we get into concepts. And the concepts of financial statements. And these are statements that basically everyone, even the biggest of biggest companies, Google, publish every quarter. And there are two main financial statements that you should learn about. And again, as I mentioned at the beginning, it's all common sense. you guys already know the concepts. Now if you know the names, you're golden. You can go and talk to anybody. You can go to the Wall Street and you can start talking about, hey, my firm, what's your name, Fisher? My firm, Bubbletech, has a P&L statement that we're going to publish every quarter, and we also have an income statement that shows that we're making massive profitability and an EPS of 2 cents a share, and also our balance sheet is extremely solid. You can go do that, because fundamentally inside all of that, the concepts you guys know. Now you start learning about how to put those concepts in which statement, you're golden, right? So profit and loss is nothing but what we talked about. What's your cost? What's your total revenue? You subtract the cost from the revenue and you either make a profit or you make a loss. That's your profit and loss statement. Simple, right?
Yes. Yes, simple.
The balance sheet, on the other side, gives you information on the company's well-being, right? So what are your assets? And assets are what all aspects of what you need to run the business that you own, right? So if you buy 10 computers, if you buy a building where you will house your startup, all those are your assets, right? So they go into the balance sheet. And liabilities are the opposite, which is what monies you owe outwards. So if you've taken a loan, or if you have to engage in mechanisms where every month you have to pay out something, those are your liabilities. Now if you put these two together, that constitutes all of the financial learning that you need to do in order to get your startup up and running and be intelligible when you go and talk to a VC. They will look, when you go to a VC, they will look for these two financial statements from you. Right? We'll talk a little bit more. I know this one is very easy. That one, we'll talk a little bit more so that you learn about it. It's a little confusing what assets are. But think about what I own and what I owe as the two main concepts. So we'll get into it. Next video. Okay, let's look at a video on profit and loss statement.
A profit and loss statement, or P&L, is an account compiled to show gross and net profit or loss during a specific time period. Profit or loss is equal to your income minus your expenses. For example, you manufacture widgets and sell them to your customers over the internet. During the month of June, your income was £10,000. The first expense you need to subtract is direct expenses. A direct expense is any cost directly related to the production and sale of your product, such as raw materials, shipping costs, and labor for assembling the widgets. For this example, your direct expenses are £4,000. This gives you a gross profit figure of £6,000, or 60% gross profit. Next, you need to remove your operating expenses from your business during the month of June. This can include advertising, accountancy fees, heating, lighting, rent, salaries not directly related to sale, and more. For this example, your operating expenses are £4,500. So if we take the income...
I'm pausing there for a second, purposefully. Look at the costs of doing business, right? Did you guys know that you have to pay your PG&E bill? Heating? That's a cost, right? Did you know you have to pay rent? Did you know you have to pay for your internet charges and for the calls and when you get a cell phone from your startup? So I see a lot of entrepreneurs when I work with them, they discount, not thinking through the cost associated of doing the startup, right? They think, I'll pay salaries to a few people, and then maybe I'll pay when I have my application. I'll pay Apple their revenue share for that dollar, and those are my costs. But think through, there are a lot of costs when you do a startup. You buy a laptop, that's a cost, right? You you pay for entertainment, you go out for dinner as a team, so that you can all work and build on your idea. That's a cost, right? So don't discount the cost. Always think through all the costs associated with doing the business. And if you do that, then your statements will become very solid, because the VCs will look at that. And VCs, a lot of times, a lot of startups, when I look at it as well, you look at it and say, you guys haven't even thought through your business plan. As an entrepreneur, you should know that it costs these things. If you think about it, an entrepreneur goes, oh no, I didn't think about that, sorry, I'll go back. Then they come back and we say, did you think about that? Oh no, I didn't think about that, go back. Right? VCs hate that. So think through your business very deeply on all the costs that you will incur.
The direct costs and operating costs. This gives you a net profit of £1,500. If your figure is a negative, then you've made a loss during this period. Profit and loss statements show you how much money you're making or losing in a specific time period. They allow you to compare past performance and detect any issues with sales margins and expenses. Get a rebranded version of this video, along with many others, today at clickbid.com.
I don't know about you guys, but I love the British accent. Isn't it fun? How many of you can tell the British accent versus an Australian accent, versus a South African accent, versus a New Zealand accent? That's so cool if you can do that. It is so cool. I love the accent. Anyway, okay, enough of digression. So then at the end of the day, what you saw in that video is keep your costs all in your mind, make sure you've covered it fully, and then always yield toward this magical formula. If you have this magical formula, which is profitability, what the VCs will be looking at you is how soon will you be able to hit profitability, right? Because most startups, 99.99% of startups are not profitable from day one. You have to pump in a lot of costs into the startup, and then when you become successful and your product sells, start selling not one or two, but thousands and hundreds of thousands, that's when you become successful. And the VCs will be looking for what is the time from today to when you will be profitable. Because when you're profitable is only when they can start seeing returns for their money. With me so far? Do you have a question?
Oh, yeah. Okay, direct cost, does it count money that comes out of your pocket?
So the question is, for indirect costs, does it count the money that comes out of your pocket? So it's a slightly complicated question. At the end of the day, when money comes out of your pocket, it shouldn't be coming out of your pocket, but from the pocket of the company. So the assumption is, when you're doing a startup, you've formed a company. And by forming the company, you're an employee of the company, right? So when you're taking money from your expense and putting it from your pocket and you're putting it for the company, that's an expense. And it does fit in into the cost structure. You can charge the company, it will repay you that money. Make sense? More questions?
So the profit, whatever you get, is it yours to keep, or who gets the money?
Great question. So the profits that you make, you get to keep it. How many people say, yes, you get to keep it? How many people say, no, you can't keep it? Why not? You should be able to keep it. Right. So the profits actually belong to the company, not to you. Because you founded the company. Now, because the company is profitable, they then enhance the value of the shares that you own in the company. So if you founded it, the share was worth 1 cent. By being profitable now, if the shares is worth $1, you've made 99 cents on that share. And that is how you make money as a founder, not from the profitability and taking the money out.
But don't you get a salary too?
You do.
Okay.
You can take a salary as well. That's a little complicated here. because there are different types of corporations that you can do. You can do limited liability partnerships, you can do C-corps, you can do S-corps, or you can do simple partnerships. And in scenarios where there are different types of corporations, in some of those, you can qualify to keep the profits for yourself. But I wouldn't go there in this class. If you're interested, I can cover with you on outside on how you can form. Because what we are recommending in this class is when you form a startup, you form a Delaware-based startup, as we covered in week four. Next, please. Do you have a question?
Yeah. So, like, the share is worth a dollar, and like you own that share, like how much money
can
you get with a dollar?
So, the share was initial value was a cent, and then it becomes a dollar. Then those shares are worth 99 cents, correct? So, wait. Now, remember what's paper money. So, the question is, now if the share value has increased from 1 cent to a dollar, you get to make 99 cents. How many people say yes?
If you want.
How many people say no? Why are people lifting up the hands? Okay, how many people say yes, you get 99 cents? How many people say no, you don't get 99 cents? The answer is no, because it's paper money, right? Because until there is an exit, which is either you go public or someone buys you. When someone buys you, remember what they do is they buy out your shares. And therefore you get money in exchange for your shares, right? So till your monies are paper money, it's just paper money, right? Okay, here is another term that VCs, the VC community uses quite a bit. This goes into time to profitability. So most business plans that I see, and I have seen literally thousands of business plans from startups, every one of them have this thing called hockey stick curve, which is, we know we're not profitable from day one. Maybe after a year, we won't be as profitable. Maybe after a year or two, we won't be. But guess what? Once we get profitable, we're going to fly. And the curve goes like this, and it goes like that, right? Every startup does this. And every VC says, go back home, you haven't done your homework, because that's not feasible. Except if you have Facebook, or if you're Groupon, or one of those that have shown such hockey stick curves. So this is a well-known joke. And why I'm covering this is because one of my other goals, as you've seen in the last couple of weeks, is to teach you guys the tricks of the trade. Get you the vernacular, get you know these keywords, right? We learned paper money, we learned pivot. These are all insider terms in the VC community. So right. So this is learning for you in your vocabulary. Everybody says there's a hockey stick curve. Everybody's projections show the hockey stick curve. But be careful. Be careful when you show such projections. Make it more realistic is the key thing. Our growth doesn't look great right now, but once we release a new version, it's going to be a hockey stick curve. I've heard that 1,000 times, I can tell you that. 1,000 times, every entrepreneur comes to me and says that same statement. Next, please. Okay, we talked about costs. I'm not going to belabor this, I think we made the point in the video, which is think about cost drivers, and don't just think about, is there a question?
No, just a quick comment. Even if you're profitable initially, you may not want to take that entire profit because you may create a separate account where you're putting it for R&D research, some future expenses or product expansion or what have you.
Yeah. The point here is that if you do get profitable, and a lot of companies are facing this today, there's a company called Rocket Fuel that went public, but they were not profitable even though they went public, because they took a lot of their profits and pumped it back into research and development. And so the point here is that you also can determine yourself when you will become profitable. Right? You can build that in your own mind. Anyway, so infrastructure, administration, development, all of those are costs. So think about these drivers, in essence. Next, please. Okay, let's learn about balance sheet. I said it's a little tricky, so hopefully this video will help you.
Thank you.
balance sheet can also be described as a snapshot of a company's financial condition. Is a statement of the assets, liabilities, and equity of a business or other organization at a particular point in time. A balance sheet can also be described as a snapshot of a company's financial condition. A balance sheet is broken up into three sections, assets, liabilities, and equity. The difference between the assets and the liabilities is the equity of the company, also known as net assets, net worth, or capital. You're starting a business. You go to the bank and get a loan. On your balance sheet, this loan shows as a liability, as it has to be repaid to the bank. It also shows as an asset for the same amount, as you have the cash to spend. Thus, the balance sheet is balanced. You need to buy a computer for your new business. The cash in your assets decreases, but your new computer asset helps balance it. As you sell to your customers, your profits are recorded as retained earnings in the equity section. The cash from these profits is recorded in the asset section, and the sheet remains balanced. Every month, you make a loan payment to the bank. Your liability is reduced by the amount of the payment, and your cash is reduced by the same amount. If at any point you need to find out your business's worth, go back to the formula from before. Assets minus liabilities equals equity. Get a rebranded version of this video, along with many others today, at Collected.
All right. Did that make sense? Or did that add more confusion? Okay, very simple. Balance sheet has to be what?
Balance.
That's why it's called a
balance
sheet. Right? So in a balance sheet, you have to balance two sides. One is what you own, what belongs to you. That's your
assets.
The other side is what you owe, what you have to give back, what you have to pay back. What is that?
Liabilities.
At any given point, those two constitute a balance sheet. You start listing all of your assets, you start listing all what you owe, and you'll see a long sheet, and it on top of it says balance sheet. It gives investors the ability to learn what your net worth is, as the video said. Right? So you can, as a startup, own 50 computers, whereas you as a startup can own 20 computers, you will be deemed to have more worth than you. You can have 50 employees, and you can have 10 employees, you'll be deemed to be more worthy because you have more people working for you. Right? See what I mean? So that's how the condition of a startup is determined. That's how people assess how valuable a company is, and that's why it is so important to publish this financial statement. With me so far? Easy peasy, right?
Yes.
Thank you. All right. We are at the end of making you guys financial experts. Congratulations. Give a clap to yourself. Okay, my financial experts. Now the next task is to see how many of you did your homework. The homework was, next slide please. Introduce your family, your team. Does everybody have a team? We'll go to do the same thing as last time. Does everybody here have a team? Who does not have a team? Hands up please. Can you line up here for me please? We will find your team. As easy as that. Okay, the rest of you who have a team? How many of you have started how many of you have started the process of building a business plan? Okay, good. I see all hands. I'm super proud of you guys. How many of you have questions on building the business plan? Or is it easy? You've taken care of it. How many of you have questions on building the business plan? Okay. So for you guys, we can see you next week with you completed business plan, yes?
Yes.
Okay, good. But before you go, I want you guys to add some key members to your founding team. Because remember what we said, as a team, we all rise. Individually, we all
fall.
Right? And as you grow as a startup, you have to hire key members who have key skills that you don't have. You hire to fill your
weaknesses.
You hire to fill your deficiencies. Right? So if I have a startup and I'm going great guns, and I have software engineers, and I have people building out UIs and testers and all of that, but I don't have people who can do the stuff we learned today. Guess what? The VC is not going to see you. We need a financial person. Right? So let's see how we can fill your team with these guys. Okay, so show of hands, how many people have at least less than four people in your team? How many teams have less than four people in your team?
We're not sure. We're not sure about the other one. But we have a team.
Okay. You have a team? Alright, you want to come up?
Yeah.
All of you come up. Think about, I'm going to ask you a couple of questions. What's your passion? What area do you specialize in? And you can say, I'm a programmer, or I'm very good at thinking about concepts, or I'm very good at thinking about how to do social good, I'm very good at building out mechanisms of marketing. Right, so I'm going to ask each one of you what your passion is. And then you, all of you, startup owners, think about if you need someone with that passion in your team. Yes? The same exercise the last time. Very easy, guys. So who wants to start? What's your passion?
I like sports. Basketball. Social media sites. Those kind of websites.
Okay. Social media, sports, think about if you need someone with that expertise. All right, we found your team. What's your idea? That's great. Painless allergy testing. You want to join the team? All right. That's great. Okay, all of you sleeping giants, can we hear? We found a team. Thank you. Thank you. Who wants to go next? You want to go next? What's your passion? You like to do social good, right? Yeah? What would you like to do? You want to join a startup? Yeah? He wants to do a social good?
He does a lot of Java.
A lot of Java? We have a programmer, guys. This is very hard to find, I'm telling you. A programmer is extremely hard to find. You're a programmer, yeah? Great job. A programmer is extremely hard to find. Who wants a Java programmer? I want to see a few show of hands here, guys. I'm sure a lot of you need Java programmers. Allergy testing. Would you like to do allergy testing app? Yeah? Can he join your team? All right, we have one more match, guys. Mac and iOS developer, guys. I want to see, like, if I was in the crowd, I would be putting both my hands up. What's your passion? Programming passion too, oh my god.
Sure.
You get a person working for you day in and day out, because I used to be a programmer, and when I used to get into programming, I used to spend like, I used to forget sleeping. I'm serious. Programming is very addictive. Okay, you get to choose. You're lucky, aren't you? Okay, who give me your ideas so that you can choose.
So basically, we have an idea. Our company's name will be Bubblehead, it's like an idea. Our group is like,
I know there's some wires coming to TV or something. We're gonna try to call that wireless, oh, but not like the something else.
All right, decluttering what's behind your TV. I like that. Can I sign up to be a first customer?
Kind of like, I don't know if this exists, but if you have stuff that you don't use and you can make money off of, people who want it can rent it for a while and they will take some of their.
Yeah, I love that.
Yeah, so basically it's just like an app used for like loading stuff to others. So like they won't like waste a bunch of materials, time, and a lot of money.
Yeah. Ways by which you can, if you have extra stuff, to either give it away or rent it out. Who else wants a Mac and iOS developer? We could, but I would prefer to keep it manageable. Five, but we could. You have five already?
Yes.
You want to buy out? It's up to you if you want a six person. What's your idea?
So just our idea is that we're creating an app where
guys, pay attention here. It's a great idea. How cool is that? Studying and playing together. Why did that concept didn't exist when we were growing up? Studying and working and playing together. Okay, more. You have great idea. The environment and how to deal with it. Right, kind of what we did the week one. Yeah? Yeah, I love those ideas that came out week one. Okay. You have questions for your members maybe as follow up, or do you want to choose? He's ready to choose.
Those people.
All right, those people. What's the name of your startup?
Rent Now.
Rent Now. All right, Rent Now, everybody. You know what makes me most happy is when people work together. It's all about teamwork, right? It's all about teamwork. Everybody has a team now? Yes? Okay, who wants to come up and talk about their idea before we disperse for today? Just gently talk about your idea. We heard your idea, so I will go. If you want to come up and talk about your idea, get your whole team up. Very quickly, what's the name of your startup and what you're doing and how far along are you in creating the business? Three questions, right? What's the name of your startup? What's your idea? And how far along are you in building the business?
So what's the
startup?
I care.
I like it.
It helps like middle schoolers and high schoolers who need to complete like volunteer hours. So, but it's for everyone. It's not just for like
far along are you on your business plan creation? Can I see it? Wow. Yeah, pretty far along. I was tricking them. Good job, guys. You want to say anything? Everybody, I care. Show them that you care. Okay, who wants to come up and talk about the startup? Come on up. You guys are 5 guys, right? 4 guys. So let's think about here. Very quickly, we have to, people are starting to leave, so we have to very quickly. 3 things. Remember 3 things? What's the name of your startup?
The name of the startup is
Game Edu Academy. What's your idea?
Thank you.
big applause. Let's do one more and then we can disperse for today. What I would say before, as people are starting to walk out, please, your homework, I can give you specific homework, but I'm not. Because what I'd like you to do is to start, take the business plan, there are slides, just start filling out those slides. And it's okay if you don't get it perfect, just start filling it out, and then start showing it to me, I can help you build the business plan out. Remember, we're only 2 more weeks away from when you'll be presenting those business plans to people who will be guests, right? One more thing before you run away, guys. Next week, prepare to be inspired. Next week, I have a guest speaker, and I promise you, you'll be super inspired. I won't say any more. It's a secret, but the guest speaker is a very accomplished person, and she is as old as you guys. So you'll get very inspired. She's a high schooler, very inspiring for you guys. Okay, who else has a burning desire to come up and speak? If not, we can disperse for today. You guys want to present what was next? Okay, not today. Anybody else want to talk about their startup idea? All right, business plan, 2 words for homework. Have a great weekend, have a great next week. We will see you next Sunday with a special guest.